talk to you about the Rainy divergence and a few applications in lattice-based cryptography. So first I will do some introduction and recalling a few theoretic results, some of which are already known, a few others are new, and then I'll present a few applications in lattice-based cryptography. So unfortunately I will only be able to present three of the five results contained in the work, and the rest is in the paper version. And then I will finish with the conclusions and a few open questions. Okay, so first, what is the Rainy divergence and why should we use it? So when we do security proofs involving distributions, so the standard approach is to take the statistical distance to do proofs. So you take our problem relying on some ideal distribution which will be noted Q in this talk, and if you replace Q by a real-life distribution P and the statistical distance is small enough, then we win. The problem is still hard. And in lattice-based cryptography, a few works by Stele, Steinfeld, and co-authors of them has shown that it's often relevant to replace the statistical distance with the Rainy divergence because you get sharper proofs and sharper bounds, especially when you use cushions. But the problem is that it's trickier to use because many nice composition properties that and multiplicative properties that the statistical distance has are not verified by the Rainy divergence, and so the motivation of this work is to formalize and optimize the use of the Rainy divergence in security proofs. That will be the first part. And the second part is five more applications of the Rainy divergence. Okay, so the definition of the Rainy divergence is given here. So if you consider A, which is in 1 plus infinity, then the Rainy divergence of two distributions P and Q is you take the sum for any x in the support of P of Px to the A over Qx to the a minus 1, and that to the power 1 over a minus 1. And so it's actually defined even for other values of a, but since the behavior of the Rainy divergence is qualitatively different when it's outside this bound, I'm only going to consider this bound. Okay, so if we consider a cryptographic scheme which is doing Q queries to a distribution Di, and we know the probability of an event breaking the scheme epsilon I, so with the statistical distance we have an additive property, which is an additive inequality which is given here, and if we want to have a meaningful security proof, we need the statistical distance delta to be less than 2 to the minus lambda, where lambda is the security parameter. And with the Rainy divergence, we have something really different because we have a multiplicative property, so epsilon 0 will be bigger than epsilon 1 to the a over a minus 1, and this is divided by the Rainy divergence of the two distributions to the power of q. And so here instead we need the logarithm the Rainy divergence to be less than 2 to the minus q to win. By winning, I mean having a meaningful security proof. And so if we have, say, equal values of the Rainy divergence and of the logarithm of the Rainy divergence and the statistical distance, then the Rainy divergence is more interesting when q is much less than 2 to the power lambda. And this was already observed by in the work of Bai et al. At AsiaCrypt 2015. And why it is interesting in lattice-based cryptography is because in the upcoming call from NIST for post-quantum schemes, they consider the following bound. They consider Q to be less than 2 to the 64, and they consider lambda to be either 128, 192, or 256. So we can see that there is something to be gained if we manage to make the Rainy divergence small enough. Okay, so now we'll recall and present a few new or already known lemmas. So the... Can I move this? Okay, so the first result is well known, is a tail-cut lemma, that if you have two distributions, d delta and d delta over d is less than 1 plus delta, then the Rényi divergence is less than 1 plus delta to the a over a minus 1. And so using Taylor series, you can say that for a typical value of a, this will be more or less 1 plus delta. And so a useful use case is when you have, say, the perfect distribution. In the left example, it will be perfect Gaussian, and of course, usually in lattice-based cryptography, you cannot. It's often convenient to cut the tail of the Gaussian because you want because say you compute the Gaussian with a distribution table, and you don't want an infinite distribution table, and so this this lemma allows you to take. To say where you can cut the tail of the Gaussian, and typically if you use this lemma instead of if you use the Rényi divergence instead of the statistical distance, you can take a shorter table. Now the second one is much more interesting because instead of this, instead of the first condition, you consider that the ratio between the two distributions is upper bounded as in the first case, but also lower bounded by 1 plus or minus delta. And so the nice part about this is that when you are going to compute the Rényi divergence between the two distributions, so in this new lemma, you get something which is 1 plus a delta square over 2. So instead of having a Rényi divergence which is 1 plus delta, or 1 plus big O of delta, you get something which is 1 plus big O of delta square. And from a practical side, typical situations where this arises is that you are doing computation using a finite precision, which will be which will give you a relative error of delta, and then this tells you, okay, you have a relative error of delta. Then the Rényi divergence between the perfect and the imperfect distributions will be bounded by this value. So now a third lemma is related to the max log distance, which was introduced by Michoncho and Walter at Crypto 2017. So in the paper by Michoncho and Walter, they present a new sampler over V, and to analyze properly this sampler, they introduce the max log distance, which is defined as the max of log p minus log q over the support of p. And which is nice about this is that it's a distance, unlike the Rényi divergence. You can use useful inequalities such as the triangle inequality, which is also symmetric, and so on. And Mitchell Showalter, they essentially states that if the max log distance is less than 2 to the minus lambda over 2, then we win. And in this work, I present Weaver-Pinsker's inequality. So Pinsker's inequality, it connects the Rényi divergence, sorry, the Kullback-Leibler divergence to the statistical distance. And in this Weaver-Pinsker inequality, I connect the Rényi divergence to the left to the max log distance to the right. And so essentially we have Rényi divergence is equal to 1 plus big O of max log distance square. So in practice, the consequence is that instead of having to have the max log distance less than 2 to the minus lambda over q, over 2, you only need max log distance essentially less than 2 to the minus q over 2. So you replace lambda by q. It's not q, it's log 2 of q. So you replace typically 2056 by 64. So on the more practical side, a framework for using the Rainy divergence is you take your favorite scheme and you set more aggressive parameters. So in my experience, the proper way to do this is first to try to apply the relative error lemma, because it's the most powerful of the lemmas I presented. If it doesn't work, then you can try to apply the tail-cut lemma or the reverse Pinsker's inequality. And you need the Rainy divergence to be less than 1 plus 2 to the minus q, and it will be fine to have a tight security proof. To say that, okay, in the first case, my security is lambda bits of security with q queries, then you will lose at most 1 bit of precision if you switch from the first distribution to the second one. Also you need to parameterize the Rainy divergence, and taking A equal to lambda gives tight efficient proofs, also in my experience, because if A is too small, then your proof will not be tight, and if A is too big, then typically you will not be able to use the relative error lemma, which is sad because it's the most powerful of these lemmas. And something to keep in mind is that these arguments, they are valid only for such problems. And for decision problems, it's still an open question to achieve the same efficiency. And so in the rest of this presentation, I will often give numbers, and these numbers assume that we have less than 2 to the 64 queries as per the NIST call for proposals. Okay, so I will present a few applications. So the first application is related to the paper from Ichancho and Walter I talked to you before. So in this paper, they introduce a Gaussian sampler over the integers, because you need a lot of Gaussian samplers to do in lattice-based cryptography. So in their work, they perform a max-log distance-based analysis of the sampler, and they find that if you have 64 bits of precision, then the max-log distance is less than 2 to the minus 50, and you have about 100 bits of security. So in this work, I use the reverse Pinsker's inequality that I described before, and with 64 bits of precision, you get a Rainy divergence which is less than 1 plus 2 to the minus 96. So actually, we can claim 256 of bits of security, even with up to 2 to the 94 queries. And this security is entirely for free, because it's a black box analysis. You just, from the max log distance, you get the Rainy divergence, and you get your security claim. Okay, so the next applications, there are two applications which are related to trapdoor samplers. So trapdoor samplers, essentially they use the knowledge of the secret basis B to given a query which is typically a value C of the space underlying a lattice, but not of the lattice itself. They act like oracles which give you a point of the lattice which should be close to this point. And obviously it should be close, and it should not leak the secret basis which is used. So it allows a lot of constructions like Eschenstein, IB, Standard Model Signature, and so on. And the current algorithms, so there is one from Klein, there's also the one proposed in by Gentry, Packard, and by Kuntanatan. In the paper where they introduce trapdoor sampling, and this one is actually the same as Klein's, and there are a lot of more of samplers, and they all use floating point arithmetic. They all essentially perform big O of n square or big O of n log n operations using floating points. So that's a lot of floating points, and you need to and so it's usually a bottleneck in terms of speed. So in this work, I present two axes of improvement for trapdoor samplers. So first, squeezing the standard deviation with which it can be used, and second, reducing the required precision. So first, I will present the first one. Okay, so I will take as an example maybe the most well-known sampler, which is the sampler by Klein, which is also the GPV sampler. So it takes a matrix, it takes a sigma, which needs to be bigger than a certain value proportional to the Gram-Schmidt basis of B. You have the GSO, the Gram-Schmidt orthogonalization of B. And you have a target T, and it will output you a vector V, such that Vb is a Gaussian distribution over the lattice generated by B of standard deviation sigma and of center Tb. So now, the part where it's important to know how to well parameterize sigma is that it's well known that if sigma is too small, then this will not behave like a Gaussian oracle anymore, and it will leak the secret basis, and it actually opens the door to learning attacks such as the attacks from Nguyen Regev and Duque Nguyen against N2 sign and GGH sign. So essentially, if the point will be sampled in a parallel pipette which is dependent of the basis, and so if you make enough queries, you will learn the basis. So you need to put sigma to be large enough, but if it's too large, then your Gaussian will perform no meaningful operation from a cryptographic sense, in which I mean that it's not solving a hard problem. If it's too big, then it will sample from any point in the lattice, and you cannot use it to do signatures, typically. So we need to find the right sigma, and we need to find it in a most optimal way possible. So there are two constraints. The should not be too large, because otherwise the algorithm is useless in cryptography, and if it's too small, then it leaks the basis. Okay, so this was summarized what I just said, that you have the back curve, which is the curve linking the hardness of the problem solved by the trapdoor sampler with sigma, and if sigma is super large, then the security parameter lambda will be very small. But on the same way, if sigma becomes if sigma is too small, then you will leak the basis. So actually, what we want is to put ourselves in the intersection of the two curves, and each curve gives each curve quantifies the hardness that you get either by considering the fact of solving a hard problem or for the distribution being undistinguishable from a Gaussian. So in the analysis performed in the original paper by Gentry, Pikert, and by Kuntanathan, they use the statistical distance, and it gives you this point. And actually, if you use the Remy divergence, you can get a sharper proof which will give you this curve, and so the optimal point, the optimal value of sigma will be around here, and so you can you will have a security parameter lambda which is bigger. And now the interesting part is that if you consider the Remy divergence and you consider a limited number of queries, so here less than 2 to the 64, as soon as the security parameter is about 2 to the 64, you get almost no growth of this curve. And this means that you can take this point of intersection, which will give you a much smaller security for exactly the same lattice and the same algorithm. So in practice, if you do the analysis of between the statistical distance and the Rayleigh divergence, you gain about 30 bits of security with the Rayleigh divergence. Uh, Okay, so now we also need to study the precision of the Mitchell-Wyeth, the Trapper sampler is used, and the previous works say that a security of 256 bits requires about 150 bits of precision, and this is completely impractical because if you want to use this in a signature scheme, you will have to use a high precision arithmetic and it will be completely impractical. And so, in this work, I performed the security analysis with the Rényi divergence, and because we bound the number of queries to be less than 2 to the 64, you can actually take much more aggressive parameters because the bounds given by the Rényi divergence will be essentially linked to the number of queries and not to the security parameter. I'm a bit oversimplifying. The security parameter is still intervening, but instead of having a but its impact becomes logarithmic instead of linear. And that's why we have we can take so aggressive parameters which have 61 bits of precision. There are other applications in the paper but that I will not present here. So the second one is about revisiting the table approach. So suppose you want to sample a pseudo-Gaussian distribution using a pre-computed table. So if you do the naive approach and the statistical distance-based analysis, you get a table of a certain size and with a given precision. And if you do a Rényi-based analysis with a Rényi-friendly table, then you can take a number of values which will depend of Q, essentially, and not of lambda. And the same goes with the precision, which becomes log 2 of Q over 2 instead of lambda. And similarly, if you study the rejection sampling in Bliss, instead of computing a probability P with a precision lambda, then you compute it with a precision log Q over 2. So now, in the conclusion, so we provided tools to optimize the use of the Rényi divergence in security proofs. And a nice thing is that because of the reverse Pritzker's inequality linking the max log distance to the Rényi divergence, the fact that the Rényi divergence is not the distance is no longer a problem because we can use the max log distance for doing the computation, and when you want to get the actual bound at the end of your computation, you say, okay, now I'm going to use this theorem, and you get the Rényi divergence. Okay. So, a few open questions. Which one will I mention? So, question that I ask myself a lot is, can we use it outside of lattice-based cryptography? Because lattice-based cryptography is certainly not the only field of cryptography where you have these weird distributions and the statistical distance is maybe not optimal, and you want to switch to a metric, not a metric, but a divergence which is more meaningful and gives tighter bounds. Another open question is, can you achieve a similar efficiency for decision problems? Also, can we apply this to other Trapper samplers? So this is probably easy, but very tedious to do rigorously. And can we, so I described a few ideas in the paper with a Rényi-friendly table, but it still is an open question to see if it can be implemented correctly, in particular with respect to side channel attacks. And yes, before finishing my talk, I would like to thank Catherine Chan and the program and general chair of AsiaCrypt because it has been very complicated for me to come this year, and without their financial support, I could not have made it. So, thank you.
In your picture, I'm trying to understand the Hardin curve. What are the axes? What is the meaning of the x and y axis in the picture?
Yes, maybe I wasn't very clear about that, but so This axis, the x-axis, is the security parameter, and the y-axis is the sigma. And actually, what I maybe didn't say in this talk is that when you have your Trader sampler, if sigma is large enough, then your Trader sampler becomes undistinguishable from a perfect Gaussian. But in order for this to be true, you need it to be large enough. That's why here, the larger the sigma, the larger these three curves get on with respect to this axis. So maybe it should be switched the other way around.
Okay, and this hardness curve represents equal hardness or something? Is this like all the problems are equally hard, or what does that line mean?
Well, actually, this is an optimization problem, because this curve which gets down, it's the curve which represents the hardness of the problem that your Trader sampler is solving. If your Trader sampler solves a very hard problem, then it means that it is correlated to the fact that it has a very small standard deviation. Because then it means that trying to imitate the behavior of the Trader sampler, it will be very hard.
So you use the really divergence with a degree which is greater than 1, right?
Degree which is what?
The degree of the really divergence is greater than 1, right?
I take
2 lambda. Yes. So could it be useful to consider the Rini divergence with a degree less than 1?
Probably. I know that it behaves completely differently because, by example, if you take it equal to exactly 1, then the Rini divergence becomes the Kullback Leibler divergence, and instead of having this nice multiplicative inequality, you get an additive inequality, which I found to be not optimal to respect to the fact that Q is much less than 2 to the lambda. And if it is less strictly than 1, it remains to be studied.
Any questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank the speaker and all the students.